Blog Talk Radio.
All righty now. All praises to our Elohim, to our Father, to our Ancient of Days, to the Creator, to the Elohim of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. No idolatry here. No white Jesus here. To Yahweh Shai, to our earthly mother, to the spirit of truth. See, hold on a sec. Let me do this. Because it is time for us to blow our shofars. This Passover, I invite folks, the family, to at 6 o'clock Friday to blow your shofar. And if you don't have one, go on YouTube, find a video of a brethren blowing the shofar. You go outside, 6 p.m., and you blow it. And why is that? It's because the reverb that the Gentiles have put in the air, the reverb of their narrative, the reverb of their perspective, the reverb of their story, the reverb process, the reverb of their ignorance, says, can be broken through the sound of the shofar. And now it's time for us to do it all at once. And when we do this thing on this Friday, as well as on Monday the 8th, 6 o'clock as well, we then usher in the echo that the Father has been sending so that we can hear it, so that we can hear him. You know, Sister Powell's talking about transforming. This is how we transform in. Transformers, more than meets the eye. This is our turn. This is our time to transform. But we can only do that through the shofar, through the noise that it takes to break the reverb of the Gentiles. And it's working, and it has worked. I mean, for the last 10 years, we have been on this strong study of understanding wisdom and knowledge. And every step of the way, I remember in 2017, we were like, yo, you know, I was like, hey, you know, 2019 comes, it's going to be a great day. Like, you guys don't understand. Everyone scoffed and mocked. And I was like, you guys don't feel that? I'm like, nope. So I was like, okay. I went and I ordered me a shofar, and they were cheap then because then nobody cared. I ordered me a shofar, and I got it, and I tried to blow it. It didn't work. And I practiced, and I was able to blow it. 2019 comes, and they were partying like it was 1999. Which symbolized the last partying of their laissez-faire, their freedom, if you will, their free-edom, if you will, time. And 2020 came. We had COVID. Hold on, let me get my little timeline out here. 2020, we had COVID. In March, 2021, in March, we had the evergreen, right? All of a sudden, it just changed its course and not capsized, but just blocked the whole Suez Canal, right? Changed the whole trajectory of capitalism with one change of a meter, right? 2022, we had Russia invading Ukraine. We had Pluto coming in 2023 after 225 years. And the Gentiles saying, we don't believe in Pluto. It's not a planet. All of a sudden, these things have happened and they've culminated to this time period. And now, I've never seen on the tick of talk, or any social media where Gentiles are reading their Bible. Like, I'm just watching them just read now. Of course, they're dancing around the Old Testament, but they are reading the New Testament, and they're trying to gain some awareness. Unfortunately, they have no spirit of truth to gain it. Some, not all. Few, not many. But, you know, they are reading it. And that's a good thing in the big scheme of things for them, because some have to cleave. They don't want to cleave. They want to talk about still to this day. You know, it's funny, you know, we put down Dave and this other dude pops up. We put down Dave on TikTok, and then we got two other dudes coming on. One dude, he seems like he's from Australia, and he's just hating these black people and then talking about the paintings. Who cares? Blah, blah, blah. And then we got this heavyset fellow who on TikTok wants to spout out at the mouth about how we going to be like we will be killed if we acknowledge our rightful birthright. I mean, they are just losing their mind. And, you know, I don't really entertain them, but I give them, you know, the wherewithal to browbeat them for a quick sec. And I, you know, they try to ask questions. They don't try to ask questions. What they try to do is question my knowledge and wisdom. And when I step hard at them, when I stand up as a mighty man, the Father has them cower. And they don't keep coming. And it's interesting because, you know, this time period that we're in, you know, I was in meditation. I was asking the Father. I said, well, what is happening? And once we, as a nation, as a people, building our nation again, once we stepped into the esoteric, it was a game changer. What that did was that was the invite to the wedding. We went, we opened the door, or the door was open for us. We went into the esoteric realm. We learned about it. We understood it. We embraced it. We recognized it. We weren't fearful of it. We then were able to utilize it in terms of wisdom, righteous wisdom, and he shut the door. And now what the Gentiles are doing is they're still dealing in the exoteric knowledge. And it goes back to what I've been saying, you know, in terms of the tree of knowledge of good and evil. They can't get away from it. It's like they are they are rooted. Their roots are the tree of knowledge of good and evil. And as it should be, because they're off, right? But some of them did see us move away from them and go to the tree of life. They were apprehensive. They were kind of scared. But some of them did see, okay? Now, will the door be open for them? That's not my call. That's not my business. My business was to study to show myself approved. And at this stage in the game, we've stood up mighty, a mighty army. Like, think about how we look to them now. There's young brothers and sisters out here just speaking knowledge and wisdom of common sense of things that a lot of these people, these older people, these purry stones and stuff, can't even touch, can't even rationalize. They stutter at the thought of what we're saying now. They're stuttering. No, of course, they got to go and blow up some, you know, the key, you know, the Father had them blow up the key bridge. They want to act like it was an accident. No, it wasn't. The first thing the dude said was, we want you, everyone, we want the nation to know that it was not a terrorist attack. It was an accident. That, now, why would we believe anything a monkey Negro connected to the monkey Gentiles has to say? Why would we even care? Why do they feel their word is trustworthy? Their word has never been, their integrity is so shot up and destroyed that they can't even realize that we see them. That's why I was saying a while ago, like the 83, don't you know we see you? And then you got brethren who are in this, the Ishmaelites and all up in their business talking about, hey, you don't, you know, all up in the comments talking about you ain't, what about Ishmael? You know, Ishmael is, you need to acknowledge Ishmael. No, I don't. What I'm dealing with is Jacob. Like, this is what they're failing to realize. Everybody, now that we have risen ourselves up by the grace and glory of the Holy Spirit coming from the redemption from the Father and the allowance of doing so from Yahweh Shai, our brother, now everybody want to be down. Everybody, shoot, let's, I'm down. But, okay, you want to be down, but you got to do some work. Wait, I don't want to do no work. I don't want to do no work. But, you know, they want to do the work with the, when it comes to the eclipse. Now everybody, oh, well, you know, this eclipse thing, this thing is getting big. You know, we need to talk about it because something's amiss. You know, it. And of course, they are dismayed at these signs. We are in joy. Like, you don't, they don't understand how much joy is emanating from us. I walk around with a smile on my face. You know, some brother be like, you get that smile fit. Nah, this smile is pure joy. I'm walking around in a rapture. They don't even recognize. They don't even understand how joyful and thankful I am to be here at this point in time, to be able to stand a mighty man for the Father. Now, that doesn't mean that, you know, I got it on point and I'm a shoe-in. No, I'm constantly working, cleaning, I'm pruning, I'm seeding, I'm purifying, because I know it only takes one slip up and I'm a Gentile. Because we live in a wicked world full of vice. And it's interesting because, you know, they'll sit around and be like, oh, well, you know, the Israel is white and they're from blah 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 and they're the European and I'm going, you do realize that we know your history, right? That we understand your church history, that we know Western civilization, right? You do realize that we know all about what you're talking about. And if what you say is true, why is your world in utter chaos? Why is it slipping into madness, slipping into darkness every day? Why are barges, not barges, why are container ships busting up things, bridges? Why was there another fire on another bridge? Why is your world in utter madness? You know, why is there so much woe going on in your world right now? If Ish is the chosen, why are they murdering people? Talking about they chosen, they can do it. That don't sound chosen to me. Chosen says that we're going to get into that. Chosen, you're not. So, when they go into land, when they're in land, the world has shalom. The world has peace. The connection of Israel to the earth is complete when they go back into land. So why would the Gentiles think for a minute, in which I do understand, think for a minute, a second, or even two, that those people are who they say they are? Do they read? No. Because if they read, they'd understand that. If they read Revelation for edification, instead they're so busy in their Pauline doctrines, all in Paul. Like they don't look at, they got the Bible, they got in their hand, and they go straight to Paul. Oh, we gotta go to Romans, we gotta go to Paul, we gotta go to Paul, 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 Paul. And soon what they've done is they've created a Pauline doctrine. And that is a false doctrine. That has nothing to do with Israel, the book. Oh, well, you know, God got rid of, he destroyed and put down Israel, never come up again. And he gave the church the characteristics of Israel. And, you know, the church is now taking the place. Who says so? Where is that? Where is that? I mean, literally, you know, they have been talking so much that they now can't even rationalize their lies from what they think is true. And it's very evident in their world today. Old man Joe trying to act like this old man Joe is now doing his campaign talking about a robust economy. Joe, where you at, man? What? Inflation's down. I've done this. Joe. Maybe you think you Obama. Maybe you think you Clinton. Maybe that's it. Maybe you think that, I don't know what world you're living in, bro. But you are not living in reality. And that is their leader of the Gentile so-called free world. So it would only stand to reason that the rest of the Gentiles are delusional with him, just like him. Some of them say, you know what? I mean, I don't believe, you know, we need to do better. We got to do better. The world is not this. But then they won't even go as far as to reconcile their own history. They won't reconcile it. See, and this is what they're going to be judged on. As we know, their testimony is the lack of reconciliation for themselves. Forget us. They can't even reconcile their own truth within their own entities. They talk about a red heifer in the temple. Man, they're trying to sacrifice to another demon. Not even a demon, another devil, another deity, another principality. They keep trying to figure out a way to conjure up another Jesus. And we're going, but, you know, the time's over. That time's over. Like that's done. Don't you see Yahweh Shai on his way? Which is the which is the destroyer of the Gentiles. And I read this in the Colburn before, but let's read it again. Because, see, the Gentiles forget because they've hidden so much. They've taken so much out of, they've taken the truth so far away from them so that they can feel no pain, so that they can feel good about their killing, destroying, lying, and cheating, that they forgot about all this. And this is what the Colburn says. And it's so funny, you know, they go, oh, this is Celtic and Coptic book. Well, it's ours. You know, some of our brethren wrote this just like it. All knowledge written is either a direct or indirect knowledge or understanding from our people from the ancient times. It wasn't until the modern Middle Ages did they get their hands on this and be able to then, you know, during their rule, manipulate and create narratives that they did this, okay? But this is what it's all about. So I'm going to read it. Excerpt from Colburn Bible, a book written on brass plates. The Gentiles never wrote on brass plates about 3,600 years ago, right after the last visit of the doom-shaped destroyer, with a warning for us, a very serious warning. That's right, a very serious warning for the Gentiles. Okay? Men forget the days of the destroyer. I'm not going to read the whole thing, but it's, and I'm going to put this in the community page too, but, you know, this, it's a good read. It's a strong read. And it's a lot of things like from the beginning to the end, like these things have happened all the way through. Okay. This has already happened, these things. So it's replaying what has already occurred and what will happen in the future, all the way to the end when it talks about the comet, the Aleph and the Tav, the comet, the destroyer of the Gentiles. Okay. Men forget the days of the destroyer. Only the wise know where it went and that it will return in its appointed hour. It raised across the heavens in the days of wrath, and this was its likeness. It was a billowing cloud of smoke and wrapped in a ruddy glow, not distinguishable in joint or limb. Its mouth was an abyss from which came flame, smoke, and hot cinders. When ages pass, certain laws operate upon the stars in the heavens. Their ways change. There is movement and restlessness. They are no longer constant, and a great light appears ready in the sky. See, this we can see the same then as now. You see that the moon is changing. The Gentiles and the heathens are dismayed. They're going, hey, the moon wasn't over there last night. It's over here tonight. You know, oh, goodness, this thing is happening. What is this about? Oh, the meridian, the fault line, it could make an earthquake. See, they're all dismayed at the destroyer. This, and the destroyer is, you know, yes, it's going to be a physical, but it's really a mental destroyer first. It brings consternation. It brings dismay to those who are not grounded in the spirit of truth. That's why for us, Israel, we just need to maintain. We need to hold on to our spirit of truth. If we ever, within this course of our study of this walk that we're in, if we ever divert from that, it could be catastrophic at this point. You know, Perry Stone and them, they talk, oh, the they want to get their pontification in on the damn, on our signs, you know, without talking about us. You know, you got the J.D. Fangs wanting to do the same thing. You got, the amateur TikTokers thinking that they know everything, doing the same thing without putting the subject. It goes back to what they've done in their writings. They never bring the subject. They always put a pronoun out there. You know, they, he, you know, you, him, she, you know, that this is what they do through their writings, because they won't acknowledge the subject. What is the subject? The subject is Israel. Always has been. There's a Jubilees of 15 and 32 where he's talking about, I put principalities, I put lesser spirits over all the nations except for Israel. They are mine. So this whole concept of, oh, well, Christianity is, you know, Jesus is this and Christianity is that. Listen, those are lesser principalities. Now that we're in the spirit of truth, we can see these things. The reality is today that Israel is being regathered and has been redeemed. This is the beauty of the whole. This is the greatest story never told in 400 years. This is it. This is why nobody on the Gentile side wants to really come at us. You know, we would have healed Babylon. Here we go. We would have healed Babylon, but she cut off her comments. You see what I'm saying? Cut off the comment. Look, Babylon, we would have told you the truth, but you didn't want to comment. You want to comment, but you don't want us to comment. You know, which goes a long way in showing just who you are, because if you walked in the spirit of truth, you would be fine putting your comments out there, letting us comment on it, showing that you have studied enough to show yourself approved. But instead, you want to hide your comments. You want to not turn on the comments because you don't want to have anybody come against you. You don't want to deal in the spirit of truth. I mean, here we are for the last 10 years, all the brethren, and I'm going to say all the camps to me, because I ain't nobody, but everybody leaves their comment on from Israel, because we want to prove that we are studying to show ourselves approved. All over we do this. Every bit of social media we do this. But yet here comes these people who say they are, oh, well, we are the replacement of Israel. They don't want to talk about nothing. They want you to just deal with Paul. You know, they want to be in their Pauline doctrine. Shoot. You know, if you, do you believe in Paul? Wait, I thought I was supposed to believe in Yahweh Shai and the Holy Spirit and the Father. No. Do you believe in Paul? No, I don't believe in Paul. Oh, you're a heretic. You see? Oh, you know, you're perversing the word. Paul said that we all get in. No, listen, why would the Gentiles need to get in when they have had everything? Everything. They not only had everything, they've been everyone. So what need is it to gain salvation, Gentiles, if you have everything? See, the reason salvation comes is because of the oppression of the nations. Because salvation would not need to come if the world was righteous. There would be no reason for salvation. Yahweh would never have come back to ensure that we got salvation, because he knew you wouldn't give us salvation. But if you were going to do the right thing, if he knew that you were going to do the right thing, nations, would he have not given you salvation right then on the spot? He'd have said, hey, you know what, Gentiles, I know y'all going to do the right thing for my people. So you know what? We're going to live in peace. It's all going to be love. Everyone gets salvation right now. Did he say that? No. He said, I've come for the lost sheep of the house of Israel. I have to bring salvation to my people. Why? Because he knew that the heathens were going to torment them for a long time. Why? Because he knew that his people needed to be broken. We had to be broken and built back up. That's a coach's thing. And it makes sense. You know, some kids will come into a team and think they about the team, they about it, it's about them. And that's how our ancestors were. Imagine knowing that you got the Father at your back. I mean, shoot, I stop myself at times from my ego getting all caught up going, you know what, shoot, I'm rolling, I'm do. No, I can't do that. The Father's looking eyeballing me. Nigga, who are you to me? Because I have no respect of peoples, but you my peoples, but you better get yourself. You need to check yourself. So I don't even want that conversation. That's like going to your job and always being late. I don't want to have that conversation with my boss right now. I don't want to have a conversation with the Father of why I'm doing what I'm doing, why I'm not doing what I'm what I'm not doing when I should be doing. Or what I'm doing when I should not be doing. You know, I just want to enjoy the peace, the saving out of Jacob's trouble. You know, yes, I want to see the look on the face of the Gentiles, but I'm watching that now. I'm looking at them now. They look, and let me side note this. Now they got, where's my little note? Now they got demon face syndrome. But the demon face syndrome is not the person with the demon face. It's the person who sees the demon face. So now that the veil is about to be torn, is all this a coincidence? Hells to the no. Now that the veil is about to be torn with the Aleph and the Tav, indicating the end of the 400 years, the X over the U.S., the full gathering, regathering, gathering of the people, the full pouring of the Spirit of Truth. Now all of a sudden we get to see the demons on these people. Black, white, Puerto Rican, Haitian. It don't matter. It's not color. It's the spirit. And we now get to start seeing these people's spirit. Like, I'll tell you what, Diddy's bitch ass, that dude was looking crazy back in the day. I was like, that's an ugly fellow. I mean, literally, I mean, I'm a male. I'm not really checking him out. But I'm like, that dude's not
I mean, that's an ugly fellow to me. You know, he was kind of goofy looking. And now he looked, and then he went on social media, he looked bad then. I was like, ooh, that dude don't look right. Now he's looking even worse. The demons that these people have been putting, that have been utilizing for their fame and fortune is now showing who they are. And we're starting to see it all over the place. Demon face syndrome. Now, when I saw it, I was like, this got to be a joke. And I looked into it. No, this thing's real. This is what the, and that goes to second Baruch, right? The 12 woes, the attack of the Shadim, the Shittims, the specters. This is, all of it will be mingled at the end in the 12th woe. This is what we're seeing. And it's great to be seeing it. Because if you're seeing it, you can be protected from it. You can fight against it. You can move out of its way. If you're seeing it, if you don't see it, then it can overtake you. That's why this thing is so great to us. Like, it is a beautiful time to be us. I love me. And ain't no arrogancy or ego or comp. No, because for so long, I didn't really love myself. I just didn't. I was like, damn, I wish I was this. I wish I was that. Why is me? Woe is me? This, that, and the third. But now I'm like, yo, I mean, and I'm sure we all are feeling this air of strength of self, this innate spiritual awareness that is making our minds bring forth much love. Now, I remember being back in much love to ourselves and our people. I remember being in Atlanta in the 90s, and, you know, you'd be walking down the street and your brothers wouldn't say nothing to you. Brothers, I mean, in D.C., my brothers wouldn't say nothing to you. You couldn't even really eyeball another brother. You couldn't even dap him up. But you know, if that brother knock you in the head, you know, bust your teeth out, shoot you down, you just didn't know. Now, all I see are brothers, and all we talk about is, and we communicate first is the eye, brothers and sisters, it's the eyes. We communicate, we acknowledge, we have a conversation, we smile, and we move on. And I watch these other people look at us, and they go, what? And like I ride the little trolley joint into work, and it's a lot of Indo-Europeans on it. And, you know, there's the place I work has a IT building, and a lot of them go to the IT building. Nevertheless, that's a side note, just say where they're going. But they get on, and when we brethren and sisters have a conversation, I can see them, because see, they'll get on there and they'll be blah, 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 to each other, you know, all in the middle of the joint, you know, of the train. They don't care if they, you know, they want to sit here. They, you know, they don't care. But the moment that we do, everybody quiet, trying to understand what we do. And that's how I know who we are. You know, and some of the brothers I talk to, they don't know who they are, but I do. So because I do, I watch. And because I watch, I can feel the spirit of, do they know? Do they know? And yeah, we know. Yeah, we know. And more of us are knowing every day. Every day. So let's get back to the Cobram real quick. Because this destroyer, because a lot of people got to understand that the comet that's coming to make the Aleph and Ta is the destroyer of the Gentiles. Some people say that it's Pluto. Could be. Some people say that it's Nibiru, could be. I say that Nibiru, Planet X, and Pluto are all the same. And this comet that comes through is the dragon, which is the destroyer. Because that thing solidified the X.
It actually, the movement, but the comet actually made the name, made the number. It was the actual symbol. It is what signified it. Then when it comes across, and I'm sure that they're gonna chemtrail everything, we ain't gonna be able to really get a good look at it. But you're gonna see the consternation all over the angst, all over the faces of the nations. They already struggling, especially here in America. Wow, they don't know what's going on. They're, you know, folks is like, I heard about this, and this thing seems like it's going to be crazy. You know, they already closing schools, got a run on the markets. The grocery stores. You know, they got the cops and the police out. You know, why would they need to do all of that for an eclipse? If it wasn't a huge, significant symbol of the exodus of the people. You don't think that the Egyptians, they had all their people out there, all the guards, they were on full duty during the times when they were catching them hands from the Father? Absolutely. Absolutely, they were all on point, ready. The same here. But the problem here is that they got all their people over in the Ukraine and over in Ish trying to save those that say they are but are not. And they're left wide open. Isn't that like the Father? He had them move the army. I'm going to move the Northern Army off the land. I'm going to make my X. It's going to be a wrap. This thing is not hard. Esoterically, we have evolved. This is an evolution. And you know, they talk about evolution and blah, 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 but, you know, in terms of the physical. But evolution is truly spiritual. We can say mental. But that's mental is nothing but spiritual, right? So the elevation, the evolution is spiritual. So this thing that we have embarked on that is coming is actually coming to, watch this, save us. And destroy them. And when we say destroy, it's not going to be, it could be a physical, I'm not sure, but it's definitely going to destroy narratives. It's going to destroy thoughts. It's going to destroy histories. It's going to expose things. People are going to be saying things. They're going to vomit up the lies that they have always hidden from us. It is going to be a beautiful day. And they go, oh, well, I don't know what's going to happen on this April 8th. Nothing. Let's go back to what Pat be saying. Ain't nothing going to happen on the 8th other than us acknowledging our freedom. It's going to be us having that last bit of acknowledgement that it is done. Like the Father, it's done. It's over. Your captivity is over. Think about how many of our ancestors, and honestly, here's how I think. I think that we are now our ancestors. I think that all of these spirits, you know, last fall, Judah was talking about how the fall was closest to the ancestors. That's why they do Halloween and all that. It was used to be a different celebration for us. But it was when the ancestors was closest. I believe that closeness, that close proximity to our ancestor spirits never changed from that point. Why? Because that was the eclipse. Why? That was the ring of fire. Why? Just like Brother Yaquab said, that thing, that eclipse fell on the left hand of Virgo. It signified the wedding. That's why I'm talking about the esoteric understanding, wisdom that we gained. You know how far we went into the esoteric, how much we understand, how we can now see things differently from the time, the moment that Brother Maine came into it, that Judah, that Levi, that Abdul Seer, that Pat. I mean, this thing is so massive. That
It's a wonder that the Gentiles ain't taking themselves out already. Because they know. They know. This is a year of their election. We would be inundated and bombarded with all their madness right now. You don't see all that stuff on TV? You don't see it all on TV? What we see is a bunch of misery is what we see. Misery. And they trying to act like Biden again. Biden trying to act like, oh, yeah, this is a robust economy. Who are you trying to lie to, man? You lying to yourself? See, this is what I'm saying. The Gentiles have been lying so much that they now have lied to themselves. And it's a sad, sad day for them. Now, if they turn around and start cleaving, and it's interesting, we're seeing Jeremiah 16:19 out in full force now. Lots of them coming out saying, we've been lied to. We've been lied to. We seeing it. Next going to be Wisdom of Solomon. We seeing it. We seeing our scriptures play out like we have manifested this in the esoteric realm that the Gentiles cannot go to. That they are off limits. That is not their place. They are not allowed to go to the esoteric realm. Because when they go to the esoteric realm, what do? They create, they conjure, they want to use black so-called magic. They want to put in witchcraft. They want to look into the demon, into hell, because their minds are not righteous. So this ain't no occult that we talking about. This ain't no cult or no occult. This is esoteric wisdom, righteous wisdom. And it's difficult for them, right? Their whole existence, their whole beings have been based on a wicked world. Shoot, they don't even understand. They don't understand to be a handmaid and a servant in a righteous world. I mean, what's the other option? I mean, they're going to be like, yo, of course I'll be a handmaid, a servant over in this righteous world up underneath you all and Yahweh Shah. Of course I would do that because the other option is death. Oh, I ain't going to be, I'll never be a servant or handmaid up under you niggers. To hell with that. Death. Bye. Be gone. The other ones that are cleaving, they're cleaving because they realize the Father has already, and this is, okay, so Gentile is not a color. This isn't about white and black. This is about mentality, spirituality. Yes, the foolish people who are caught up in black and white and race will be moved out the way. There's your two-thirds. We talk about two-thirds of them YOLOing it. And, you know, no, the two, yes, that's part of them. That's going to be some. But the majority is going to be the ones that's mindset can't get past the hate that they have for someone's skin. That mind you, have had our skin and gender are the things that we had no control over. And that's the one thing that the foolish heathens, the silly Gentiles, let me change that. That's the one thing that the ignorant Romans, okay, because we can call them out on that part, the ignorant, debaucherous Romans created to divide as they stole our inheritance. So whoever is doing that madness will be cut off. And the ones that say, you know what, they were worshiping next to me before we all knew that Yahweh Shah was so-called black. So who is it to me to not worship Yahweh Shah? Because that's the point. Because we worship the Father, right? We love Yahweh Shah, right? And we love our mother, right? The Holy Spirit. But to them, they've been worshiping Yahweh Shah. That's something that they're going to have. That's not my business. That's them and Yahweh Shah, them and the Father, them and the mother. They're going to sort them out. But they have to be able to acknowledge, hey, I'm okay with being up underneath you guys. because all we want is truth. All we want is righteousness. We're not out here trying to destroy. We're not out here trying to murder. We're not out here trying to take and steal and kill and rape. That's not what we're doing. The mass majority of us is not doing that. That's these foolish Romans and Greeks and the Gentiles and the heathens. We're not doing that. Yeah, Puffy's a heathen. Straight up, straight down, a freaking heathen. And he's getting what he deserves. All of them up in that, every one of them, everybody, and I'm going to go on the limb here, and I'm going to make this statement, because this is how I feel. It's what the Spirit's telling me to say. Everybody who is on the tell a lie vision is a heathen. Because fame and fortune comes at a price. And the ultimate fame and fortune of the world, of the heathen world, is to be on the tell a lie vision. Simple as that. So they're all debaucherous. So when they talk about Nickelodeon got this, you know, they messing with the kids and all, yeah. I mean, parents, if you didn't know that parents, you were all caught up and enamored in the idol of the money. That you sacrifice your kid. Now these kids got poked in the behind and, you know, fondled and, you know, done different wicked mess to. And now they all on Puffy's plane and on Epstein's island. You know, I mean, what do you expect? You wanted the fame and fortune and everything that goes along with that. And those things that go along with that is debauchery. That goes back to what Pat was saying last night, Sister Pat, about Sodom and Gomorrah. Yeah, it wasn't just a bunch of homos running around. That's stupid. That is just evangelical stupidity. It was all of it. It's the same as it is now. You have the same thing going on. It is, what is it, the Hellenistic, what's it called when they do, oh my goodness, that's how the Father works. He don't want me to even remember. But it's the debauchery of Greece is what this world's sexual problems are, okay? Because Greece was a degenerate people. Rome was a reprobate, degenerate people. The rest of the world that all wants to be part of Greece and Rome are debaucherous, reprobate people, but they're all reprobate. So now here we are at the end. The Father's like, yo, it's time to wake up my people, okay? Now it's time to gather them, okay? Now it's time to end their captivity forever. And now you look, we look around and the heathens are in disarray. Like chickens with their head cut off. I don't know which way to go. I don't know which way to go. Their moods are swinging like... And I'm like, damn, dude, what's going on? I mean, can't we just get along? Oh, my God. But anyway, we are the prize. The prize is the Father. We are his prize, and he is ours. And this is where it is. All our ancestors are fighting with us right now. They're coming into us, like they're surrounding us. The spiritual war is strong, and we're winning. Matter of fact, we've already won. We already know that. It's we've won. Now it's time for us to manifest the same winning here in the physical that is happening in the spiritual. This is where we are. So I digressed a bit, but okay. So I'm going to put this Coburn Bible, this section of the Coburn Bible, in the community section for you guys to read if you want. Okay, it's a great read. It goes into a lot of understanding, and it's about the destroyer. Okay, now I'm not going to read any more of that. If we just take that, the destroyer, right, and we go over to Jeremiah 4:7 because we want to tie this stuff together, right? Jeremiah 4:7 is telling them, hey, the lion has come up from his thicket. That's us. And the destroyer of the Gentiles is on his way. Yahweh Shai, the comet, the destroyer.
He has gone forth from his place to make thy land desolate, and thy city shall be laid waste without an inhabitant. This is what's going to happen to Babylon, to the nations. Their cities will be laid waste. It goes back to what I've been saying before about, you know, the about commercial banking. The cities are already laid waste. There's not many people in these commercial buildings. There's just not. And I'm watching the cities literally being laid to waste. No, and you know, some brothers and sisters were like, well, you know, my city's still good. Listen, it's not. What you see is not what's happening. What they're trying to show is not actually what is happening. The office buildings are empty. I would venture to say many of them have a for lease sign on them. And if you go around, you'll see a lot of, even in your shopping areas, for lease, stores is closing up in malls. Because it's going to be laid desolate. The dollar, the idol, the main idol of this world has to be destroyed. And that doesn't mean other than the bricks are going to set up. No, it's going to be something completely different. Matter of fact, why would we need that? We would just do the right thing in a righteous world. You grow pears, I'll grow apples. You grow peaches, I'll do lettuce. You know, and we all eat, all survive, and we all do this in loving understanding. How we used to, plant, and we used to have harvests, and we used to do our celebrations. This is how it looks. The rest of the world was always envious because we were the ones that were always gaining. Then we got put down and we weren't gaining no more, and they gained and they felt good about it. And now that all of a sudden their gains are drying up, now they got problems. And we're starting to gain again. And it's a beautiful thing. It's a beautiful thing. And that's why this whole thing is gone. You know, they're just struggling. And we are not. Let me see something. So let me go back to the Colburn real quick, because this is what it says. Let me see. Let me find these, because I want to show some definitions here about what's happening now. This is 3:7. Thus it was in the days of heavenly wrath, which have gone, and thus it will be in the days of doom when it comes again. The times of its coming and going are known unto the wise. There are the signs and the times which shall precede the destroyer's return. 110 generations shall pass into the west, and nations will rise and fall. Men will fly in the air as birds and swim in the sea as fishes. Men will talk peace with one another. Hypocrisy and deceit shall have their day. Women will be as men and men as women. Passion will be a plaything of man. A nation of soothsayers shall rise and fall, and their tongue shall be the speech learned. A nation of lawgivers shall rule the earth and pass away into nothingness. One worship will pass into the four quarters of the earth, talking peace and bringing war. A nation of the seas will be greater than any other, America, but will be as an apple rotten at the core and will not endure. A nation of traitors will destroy men with wonders, and it shall have its day. Then shall the high strive with the low, the north with the south, the east with the west, and the light with the darkness. Men shall be divided by their races, and the children will be born as strangers among them. Brother shall strive with brother, and husband with wife. Fathers will no longer instruct their sons, and the sons will be wayward. Women will become the common property of men, and will no longer be held in regard and respect. So that word strive, it says, brother shall strive with brother, and husband with wife. So let's go. Strive. Make great efforts to achieve or obtain something, or struggle or fight vigorously. Okay. In those days, men will have the great book before them. Wisdom will be revealed. The few will be gathered for the stand. It is the hour of trial. The dauntless ones will survive. The stout-hearted will not go down to destruction. Stout-hearted. Let's go. courageous or determined. That's where we are. We are courageous. We're standing in the face of these heathens telling them you're wrong. They're coming at us talking about you're black, you're not this, you're not that. We're just saying you're wrong. Prove it. They got nothing. We're stout-hearted now. This is the mighty men that the Father was talking about, okay? Let's keep going. Real quick. Great God of all ages, alike to all, who sets the trials of men, okay, of man. Be merciful to our children in the days of doom. This is our ancestors who saw this thing, who wrote about this, talking to the Father about us, okay, at this time. It says, let me start again, great God of all ages, alike to all, who sets the trials of man, be merciful to our children in the days of doom. Man must suffer to be great, but hasten not his progress unduly. In the great winnowing, be not too harsh on the lesser ones among men. Even the son of a thief has become your scribe, right? Son of a thief has become your scribe, right? This is who they done stole all our information, and their sons are rewriting and rewriting and rewriting, right? This is what they're saying. Now let's go to this word winnowing. Winnowing, blow a current of air through grain in order to remove the chaff, right? So let's go to chaff. The husk of corn or other seeds separated by winnowing or threshing. Now, what does that sound like? To me, that sounds like a harvest. Sounds like a harvest. But hasten not his progress unduly in the great harvest. Okay? This thing is real talk, and we are in the thick of it. So let's move forward. And I got these windows open because this week I was studying. I just left them open for tonight. So I was looking up the Khazars because I'm under the impression, I was talking to Brother Yaqua about this before, I was under the impression, and I still do believe, that the Valley of Jehoshaphat is Ukraine, okay? Because that's where the Ukraine has a huge valley that the world's armies can fit into. And it's right on the cusp of Russia, East and West, okay? So they're all in the Ukraine right now. That's where all of them people are, you know, the fake ones over in Palestine. That is a distraction from what they're doing in Ukraine. They're massing armies in Ukraine because they hate Putin, and rightfully so, right? Because they don't like Putin. Putin don't like them, right? And Putin just blew them up, showed them who we are, right? Made them have to start questioning themselves, right? He ain't do it. The Father did it. But nevertheless, it was done. So they all over there amassing. So I was looking this up, and it says, between 965 and 969, the Kiev Rus ruler Svyatoslav I of Kiev, Ukraine, as well as his allies, conquered the capital Attil and ended Khazaria's independence. So early on, these people have been, now this is over in Ukraine, so Ukraine, Crimea, you know, all the stands, and then going into Russia, this is where the Khazarians went into. The Ashkenazis went into. And they went all the way to Russia, to Moscow, to Moscow's capital, I don't know if that's right. To Moscow, they went there, and they created a revolution. The Bolshevik Revolution. This is what that was about. And that was going on well before World War I. World War I is when they, the Ishes, decided to create this plan, to hatch this plan of Zionism coming out of Albert Pike in the late 1800s. And this is why they thought that they were going to rule the world forever, because they were going to take us out of the picture. Say they are us, and the whole world will be their footstool. But they didn't even read. Like, I don't understand these people. They don't even read their books. And if they see, this is why you know that the Father did this, is behind it all. Because if they were truly smart and intelligent, using the wisdom of righteousness, they would never have wrote the Bible. They would have taken our scriptures and hit them all, burnt them all up, redid everything, said they are the greatest, blah, 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 and that would have been it. Killed us all off, went through destroying all of us, and we'd have been no more, okay? But they didn't do that. They didn't do that, and they allowed the Bible, their Bible, their compilation of stolen Hebrew scriptures, records, they allowed it to go forth. Maybe that was the deal with Constantine. Maybe that's why they chose to take the Talmud, and that's why there's consternation then and now. Maybe that's the whole deal. I'm not sure. I got to think about that. But I'm trying to understand what smart people would do if they were. But I can't, because the word was given into the hand of the wicked. So therefore, all of this is looked at through the lens of a wicked individual. And wickedness is not, they always miss things. They always forget things. They're not smart. They're not intelligent, and they do not use proper righteous wisdom. So there will always be breadcrumbs back to them. And that's where we are today. These breadcrumbs have come back to them. And they're like, they're at the end with all the bread going, oh, it wasn't me. And we're like, well, you're holding the bread. What are you talking about? It's you, Kazaria. It's you. And you were destroyed early on from being a nation. See, they're the ones that were also, like, this thing is all paralleling itself. They were destroyed from being a nation, not because of their the Father did it, but the nations did it against them because of what they brought. They brought a lot of lewd, a lot of vice as a people, lots of vice. Okay. So I was just looking at that, and that was a little side note, because I was like, well, what language do they speak? And because somehow I got onto this tangent of them being Turkish people. Like, I'm trying to understand who these people are, these Khazarians. And the Khazarians are, and I know that, you know, we can always look this up and try to figure it out. But it just was something interesting to me that the Spirit just made me look at this, okay? And their language that they speak, they don't really have a language. You know, they're Yiddish. You know, their language is made up of different Turkish dialects. So these people don't even have anything. Now, I can understand why they think that they're chosen, and rightfully so, they are chosen by Satan to be his people. You see? So what is that? Church of Mahan paralleling the Melchizedek, right? Cain and Abel, Esau and Jacob, you know, everything is paralleling. So as the Father has us as his righteous seed, Satan had them as his unrighteous seed. Turkey, Satan's seed. I know that, you know, Babylon over here, New York, Vegas, there's certain Satan seeds. But the first Satan seat is at Constantinople, Istanbul, which is Satan's seat. That's the original. So these people have a Turkish dialect, some form of Turkey in them, coming out of Turkey, which is Satan's seat. This is who they worship. But I digress. I got off. Okay, I'll get on that. Okay. All right, let's go. Here we go. So all that is said about the Ish people, that was just a side note because I'm looking through my, this is from, so what I do is I do my studying and then I go and I leave these tabs open. And sometimes it's a lot, sometimes it's not, but this time it was a lot. And I was like, man, so I was going into some of that stuff, but nevertheless, this is where we're at now, Proverbs 14, okay? And this is why the nations, this is why we know who we are and the nations are having problems. This right here, Proverbs 14, and I'm going to read the whole thing. Let's start at, let's start at 5. A faithful witness will not lie, but a false witness will utter lies. This is what they've been doing. A scorner seeketh wisdom and findeth it not, but knowledge is easy unto him that understandeth. Go from the presence of a foolish man, when thou perceivest not in him the lips of knowledge. The wisdom of the prudent is to understand his way, but the folly of fools is deceit. Fools make a mock at sin, but among the righteous there is favor. The heart knoweth his own bitterness, and a stranger doth not intermeddle with his joy. The house of the wicked shall be overthrown, but the tabernacle of the upright shall flourish. There is a way which seemeth right unto a man, but the end thereof are the ways of death. Even in laughter the heart is sorrowful, and the end of that mirth is heaviness. The backslider in heart shall be filled with his own ways, and a good man shall be satisfied from himself. The simple believeth every word, but the prudent man looketh well to his going. This is all for us, okay? We dealt with the Gentiles. This is all for us. A wise man feareth and departeth from evil, but the fool raggeth and is confident. He that is soon angry dealeth foolishly, and a man of wicked devices is hated. The simple inherit folly, but the prudent are crowned with knowledge. This is us, but the prudent are crowned with knowledge. The evil bow before the good, and the wicked at the gates of the righteous. The poor is hated even of his own neighbor, but the rich have many friends, right? But let's go back up to 18. The simple inherit folly, but the prudent are crowned with knowledge. See, that right there is where we are. We are now on the precipice of being crowned with knowledge. Sisters, brothers, youth, and elders, the more we stay prudent in our walk, prudent in our ways, prudent in the spirit of truth, we will be crowned with knowledge. And this is, you know, goes back to Revelations 2:9, that he know who they are, that he will make them, no, it's 3:9, will make them come and worship at our feet to know that he has loved us. This is the evil bow before the good. This is what's about to transpire. Now let's go over here to Isaiah. And let's go to Isaiah. Let's start at 1. Let's go. The word that Isaiah, the son of Amos, saw concerning Judah and Jerusalem. And it shall come to pass, this is Isaiah 2. And it shall come to pass in the last days that the mountain of the Elohim's house, whole house of Israel, shall be established in the top of the mountains and shall be exalted above the hills, and all nations shall flow unto it. Right? This is the kingdom, right? And many people shall go and say, come ye, and let us go up to the mountain of the Elohim, to the house of the Elohim of Jacob, of Jacob. And he will teach us of his ways, and we will walk in his paths. For out of Zion shall go forth the law and the word of the Elohim from Jerusalem. So, okay, Zion shall go forth the law, right? You know, Zion is not Zionist. You know, I need my land. Give me my land. Zion is the land, right? It's the mountain. It is the kingdom. And he shall judge among the nations and shall rebuke many people, blue, black, purple, white, yellow, green, red. And they shall beat their swords into plowshares and their spears into pruning hooks. Nation shall not lift up sword against nation, neither shall they learn war anymore. Time out. Ish is in a land that they say is theirs, right? Oh, this is our ancient land. Then if you're in it, Ish, why are you still murdering people and going and dealing with war? Because right here it says, neither shall they learn war anymore. 5, O house of Jacob, come ye and let us walk in the light of Yahawashah, because they say, you know, Baal here, Lord, because this is how wicked these and foolish these foolish nations are. They don't even know what they put in here, these words, you know, cursing themselves and us. But not no more. You know, I had a brother come in just talking about how, and I guess he deleted his comment or whatever, but came in and was talking about how, you know, I need to speak and I need to use English. I mean, you know, we don't need to use Hebrew words for things. And I'm like, you obviously are not learned because, you know, cursing yourself is not going to help you. All that does is just put you deeper in the mire of a heathen and a Gentile. But I digress. Therefore, thou hast forsaken thy people, the house of Jacob, because they be replenished from the east and are soothsayers like the Philistines, and they please themselves in the children of strangers. Their land also is full of silver and gold, neither is there any end of their treasures. Their land is also full of horses, neither is there any end of their chariots. Their land also is full of idols. They worship the work of their hands, that which their own fingers have made. And the mean man bows down, and the great man humble himself. Therefore, forgive them not. Now, this may seem like it's talking about Jacob, but it's not. It's talking about the Gentiles that Jacob's around. That's around Jacob. That these, you know, their land is full of silver and gold. Where'd they get it from us, right? No end of their treasures, right? They got all of it, right? They got full of horses, right? Full of vehicles, right? You know, got a bunch of idols, right? And they worship everything in their hands. That's them. See, the Christians want to say this is us. No, this is them. This is what they do. Because if we apply everything to today, to the concepts of today, we're not ruling. So the things that are, you know, you want to be Israel so freaking bad. Well, now you are. Now you get to see that you are the ones who have to pay for your idolatry. For your idolatry, come on. You're the ones that's in idolatry, not us. We don't rule anything to make you believe or worship what we say that you have to do. We might have built the churches, but we don't have any curriculum of our own. It's all coming from you. Let's go to Isaiah 60. Hold on. Let's just roll. Arise, shine, for thy light is come, talking about Israel, and the glory of Yahawashah is risen upon thee. For behold, the darkness shall cover the earth, and gross darkness the people, but Yahawashah shall rise upon thee, and his glory shall be seen upon thee. This is that transformation. And the Gentiles shall come to thy light, and the kings to the brightness of thy rising. Lift up thine eyes round about and see. all they gather themselves together. They come to thee, thy sons shall come from afar, and thy daughters shall be nursed at thy side. Then thou shalt see and flow together, and thine heart shall fear and be enlarged, because the abundance of the sea shall be converted unto thee. The forces of the Gentiles shall come unto thee. The multitude of camels shall come, shall cover thee. The dromedaries of Midian and Ephah, and they shall, and they from Sheba shall come. They shall bring gold and incense, and they shall show forth the praises of Yahawashah. All the flocks of Kedar shall be gathered together unto thee. The rams of Naboth shall minister unto thee. They shall come up with acceptance on mine altar, and I will glorify the house of my glory. Who are these that fly as clouds and as the doves to their windows? Surely the isle shall wait for me and the ships of Tarshish first to bring thy sons from afar, their silver and their gold with them, unto the name of the of Yahawashah, thy Elohim, and to the Holy One of Israel, because he hath glorified thee. And the sons of strangers shall build up thy walls, and their king shall minister unto thee. For in my wrath I smote thee, but in my favor have I had mercy on thee. Therefore thy gates shall be open continually. They shall not be shut day nor night, that men may bring unto thee the forces of the Gentiles, and that their kings may be brought. For the nation and kingdom that will not serve thee shall perish. Yea, those nations shall be utterly wasted. Now, time out. Again, the way that they write, the way that they transliterated this is to keep us out of our story. So, again, they're not giving really a good subject. They move in between these who it is, Gentile or Israel, right? But here, the father is talking about the Gentiles, because the bottom line is that the Gentiles are going to come to us and worship at our feet. And they're going to come to us, and they're going to cleave. And they're going to want to do this because the alternative is death. And hey, we don't have anything to do with that. We're here to do what we need to do in preparation of the kingdom to come, because that's our first and only thought. How we are to clean up, we're to pick ourselves up, get the sinews, get the breath of life in us, stand up strong, mighty men, so that we can get to work building our kingdom, building our Father's kingdom, the beautiful thing is that we get to be redeemed and risen up to be our point. Our point is the light. Why? Because the heathens are going to come, or the Gentiles, are going to come and help us build our kingdom. Like, they forced us to build theirs, they're going to come and build ours. You see what I'm saying? Like, this is not rocket science. This is the beautiful thing. That's why I don't have no hate for these fools. It'd be foolish for me to hate a fool. Why would I? That's folly. Do I have pity? Not really. Because I know that at the end of the day, they're going to have to do what they are going to have to do. And if not, the alternative is death. And that's their business. That's why these Daves and Karens of the world that want to come at us about who we are. Are you crazy? You are sealing your own death, because I'm not out here treating you wrong. I'm not out here cursing and ranting and raving at you. I'm not out here telling you that you a slave, that your people enslaved you. Save it. I know your history. I know who you are. I know what you've done. It'd be best for you Gentiles and heathens to shut the boop up and get to cleaning yourself up, because you're going to be put to work and you're going to like it. and you're going to love it, because the alternative is death. And you're going to do it, and you're going to do it with a smile. And ain't going to be no turning back. Because I know the alternative is death. You just need to look at us. You need to look at us. What was the alternative to us was life or death. You guys got to live under your rule, talking about I live, I live, I live. I'm living.
YOLO, best life. We didn't get to do that. So in the kingdom to come, we're going to be living our best life. We're going to be ruling, but we're going to be doing it righteously, which isn't that what everybody wants? Are we not tired of this wicked-ass world under the Gentile rule? Of course we are. So now we manifest based on our word, based on the records that our Father made these heathens keep in preparation of our awakening, for us to recollect and reconcile their wicked ways with our righteous ways, their broad way with our narrow way, their exoteric understanding with our esoteric understanding, with their wicked ways to our righteous ways. This is who we are. This is what we've been built for. We're not built for anything outside of that, to build our kingdom to come so that our Father can place his altar, his throne in our kingdom. That's what this is about. All the rest of it, you know, us going against these fools, it's really to sharpen, right? It's to stay sharp and to be able to assist them in waking up. Because our wake up, again, I said this before, our wake up was, hey, wake up, babe. Hey, wake up, real soft and sweet. We were able to wake up, you know, rub our eyes, you know, stretch, oh, stand up and move. They don't get that courtesy. They get to get up, turn the lights on, ring the alarm, get up. They get shaken from their sleep. And rightfully so. But this is the beauty of who we are. We are not out here treating them the way they treated us. We don't have time for that. Our time is better spent seeking, studying, and learning how to be an engineer for the Father to build our kingdom, to manifest our kingdom to come, because we're done with theirs. Once April 8th comes, it's going to be on and popping. And you guys, we're going to see. We're going to see. The mind, the spiritual mind of us is going to just take off. It's going to take off. I already see it. I've seen it before. As a Pisces, and I hate saying that, but just who I am, I've seen it. I've seen the end, and many of us probably have, and that's great. I've seen what our end, what the end looks like, and I've seen how we start to begin to build together something that these people have never, ever seen. Again, we would have healed her, but she turned off her comments because we are the greatest story that's never been told in 400 years. So when the elephant top, the X marks the spot comes, our story will be told. All praises. All praises. All praises. I mean, that's an emotional thought. That idea of once April 8th comes, our shackles are completely thrown off. They just fall to the clank, clank, and we are free. We get our full range of free will motion back. We get our opportunities back to serve our Father in our land. This is our good news. This is our joy. And can't nobody take that from us. And we won't let them no more. We stood up. There was a sound. There was a noise. There was a grumbling. There was a loud bang. This is what they're feeling now. They're feeling all of this consternation. And I know that we feeling all of the joy. They talking about, oh yeah, after the April 8th, there's 40 days after that, there's going to be an eclipse. I mean, there's going to be a rapture. They talking about the red heifers. Let them, because those are the ones that will perish. Just simple as that. It's got nothing to do with me. That really got nothing to do with us. They grasp them for straws. Grasp. But I want to go out with this song because it was so fitting. I was listening to it the other day and I was like, yo, this is the song that tells them that we see them. All praises, Israel, all praises.
Hold on, Israel. Hold on. Because we've been feeling this all our lives. Just hold on. And we remember. Because we remember the faces that did this to us. And they're ours, along with some Gentiles. But just hold on, because our turn is now. All praises to our Elohim, our nation, to Yahawashi, to our earthly mother, the Holy Spirit, the one who comforts us and has comforted us to get to this point in time. Because it's coming in the air at night. Coming in the air tonight. Shalom.
Mow the distances back at your local Gravely dealer. Now through April 8th, you can save up to 25% with special financing available on America's most rugged mowers, including the ZTHD, the residential mower built to commercial standards. Visit your local Gravely dealer today.
Okay, round two. Name something that's not boring.
A laundry? Ooh, a book club. Computer solitaire, huh?
Ah, oh, sorry. We were looking for Chumba Casino. That's right. Chumbacasino.com has over 100 casino-style games. Join today and play for free for your chance to redeem some serious prizes. Chumbacasino.com. No purchase necessary. Void where prohibited by law. 18 plus. Terms and conditions apply. See website for details.